Good afternoon. I want to welcome you and thank you for joining us for today's webinar. I want to thank the Jewish Federation of Cleveland for providing this opportunity for our community. We have more than 400 individuals on this afternoon's session. My name is Beth Wain Brandon, and I'm so pleased to be a part of today's webinar. I'd first like to recognize the Jewish Federation of Cleveland Board Chair, David Heller, and Federation President Erica Rudin-Luria for their leadership during this difficult time. You've both navigated these uncharted waters with tremendous skill. One of the core strengths of our Cleveland Jewish community is how we care for each other. In the past year, your Jewish community, Federation, agencies, schools, and other partners have demonstrated strength, determination, and a resolve to work together to face the coronavirus and its impact on our community. And thanks to the generous support of donors to the Federation's annual campaign for Jewish needs, we've been able to respond to many of the immediate needs in our Cleveland community. We're providing food to the hungry, care for the elderly, and support to those with financial challenges. If you're struggling, or you know someone who is, please contact Access Jewish Cleveland at 216-292-INFO or 4636 or accessjewishcleveland.org. All inquiries are completely confidential. Every member of our community is important, and we want you to know we're here for you. We can't do it alone though, and we need your help. We're seeking volunteers of all ages through Federation's Jewish Volunteer Network to assist members of our Jewish Cleveland community. Please email Susan Hyman at shyman@jcfcleve.org to participate in these opportunities. Since the pandemic arrived in Northeast Ohio, the Jewish Federation of Cleveland has hosted numerous webinars featuring recognized thought leaders on the front lines of COVID-19. We want to ensure that you get the most up-to-date information available that you need to keep yourself, your family, and the community safe, healthy, and informed. Today, we are so thrilled to continue the discussion with two experts in their field, Dr. Daniel Simon and Dr. Robert Salata. Dr. Simon is Chief Clinical Scientific Officer for the University Hospitals Health System and the President of UH Cleveland Medical Center. He's the Ernie and Patty Novak Distinguished Chair of Healthcare Leadership. Dr. Simon is also professor of medicine at Case Western Reserve University School of Medicine. As Chief Clinical and Scientific Officer, Dr. Simon leads UH's 14 clinical care delivery institutes and manages all UH clinical department chairs. As president of UH Cleveland Medical Center, Dr. Simon is responsible for developing, implementing, and evaluating clinical and safety standards and practice for the academic medical center. Most recently, Dr. Simon was tapped to co-lead UH's COVID-19 preparedness, response, and recovery activities. Dr. Robert Salata is the Steris Chair of Excellence in Medicine, the Chairman of the Department of Medicine, and was Chief of the Division of Infectious Diseases and HIV Medicine for nearly 20 years at Case and University Hospitals. Dr. Salata is the founding director of the Infectious Diseases and Immunology Institute in the School of Medicine and is the medical director of infectious control and prevention at UH. Dr. Salata has also been an active principal investigator on HIV/AIDS related research studies for the Uganda CWRU Research Collaboration since 1997. We are so grateful to have you join us today to share your insight. Dr. Simon and Dr. Salata will begin by sharing the latest COVID-19 data, vaccine information, plans for distribution, and answer many of your questions that were previously submitted when you registered for this event. Welcome, Dr. Simon and Dr. Salata.
Thank you.
Thank you, Beth. Well, we have a very aggressive schedule to get on for this evening. And in the next 50 to 55 minutes, we want to update you on the state of COVID in the US and in Ohio and in our health system, and then spend the bulk of the time on vaccines. Before we jump into your amazing questions that were sent to us, I'd like to give you a very quick update on just exactly where we are right now, and we'll turn to some slides to do that. Just going to enlarge it here for 1 second. Can you see that okay?
Yes.
Terrific. So, you know, this is a great image of where we are in the peak of our third surge, looking now down at the light at the end of the tunnel to Pfizer, Moderna, AstraZeneca, and Johnson & Johnson vaccines. So in many ways, we're seeing the beginning of the end, but we're in a tough spot right now. If you look at the United States daily COVID cases, we're now coming off the third and highest peak across the country. Over 25 million Americans with COVID, and now over 421,000 deaths. Over the last 14 days, however, you can see about a 31% drop in the number of cases, a flattening of the number of deaths, and hospitalizations down about 11%. And this is obviously good news because we had major concerns about capacity of hospitalization in ICUs across the country. Ohio is in a little better shape. We're further off that peak of the surge with a 35% reduction in cases, a 13% drop in deaths, and nearly 21% drop in hospitalizations over the last 14 days. And if you look at University Hospitals Cleveland Medical Center and our whole health system across the frame, 12 other hospitals, you see that we peaked about a month ago now and are down from nearly 375 cases down to 123, with nearly a 53% drop in the number of admissions over the last 7 days, which is clearly really very good news. And we leverage predictive analytics from the University of Washington IHME model to show, in fact, that the predictions are far better than we thought. You can see in blue the most likely outcome, where university hospitals would be peaking a couple weeks from now with over 500 cases. More severe predictions over 800, and we're actually coming in the red, down now below the 200 case mark. So we're pretty confident that we turned the corner from this third surge. Many of you may be thinking, well, the vaccines are going to take us out of this predicament, and we won't need to mask or social distance. And it's really important, as you can see here in this figure, that if we lift restrictions right now, as we're vaccinating almost 1.5 million people a day now, we would have another 29 million additional infections, more infections than perhaps we've had total, if we lift those restrictions too soon. So before we ask Bob, I think, some important questions about vaccines. Let me ask you, Bob, the question that's obviously burning on a lot of people's mind, which is, okay, we're coming off the third surge. What's gonna happen with UK variants, the Brazilian variant, the South African variant? Will we have a fourth surge? And when will that surge take place despite vaccination?
So thanks, Dan, and to all of you for inviting us to speak with you and answer your questions. The UK variant, as you may or may not know, was first described in September, actually, southeast of London, and now is accounting for about 75% of all cases there in the UK. And that spread to 60 countries, and now is present in 30 states in the United States. And we have found that locally here from a recent analysis. Fortunately, we have yet to see the South African strain, which is a little more worrisome in terms of how it has evolved. All of these new variants, so to speak, have had changes in the genetic structure of the virus. But for the first time, it's starting to affect what is called the spike protein. Those of you that have looked at pictures of the coronavirus, and by the way, this is the seventh coronavirus that humans have had experience with. It's the spikes off the surface that is really what is called the spike protein. Years ago during SARS-1 in 2003, and thereafter in the Middle East with MERS, we knew that people that developed immune response to the spike protein really were protected from getting subsequent disease. So our anticipation that this was the right component of the virus to target for the immune response has held true. But when you start changing the structure of this spike protein through these changes called mutations, then we become a little more concerned that the current approach with the vaccines in hand may not be as effective. We have they have tested, that is the two approved vaccines so far, both Pfizer and Moderna. They've taken blood from individuals that have been vaccinated and isolated the antibodies, and in the laboratory exposed those antibodies to the variant viruses, and they have found that those antibodies can neutralize these variants so far. Less so with the South African strain as opposed to the UK strain. Just today it was reported that the Brazilian strain, which first came to Japan, is also present in the Midwest, but not here in Ohio yet. And it's not surprising that with the abundance of infections around the world, by the way, globally, we just passed 100 million cases, and given the high burden of infection in given individuals, that the virus would try to adapt and change, and these mutations have been seen. We can expect more in the future. To date, there have been over 4,000 of these mutations seen, but up to this point in time, we have not seen any significant consequences. Initially, it was thought that the UK virus was not going to be associated with more severe disease and death, but there's a preliminary analysis from the UK that suggests maybe that's not the case, that it may be slightly more serious than we had suspected. And the South African strain may also be a little more serious in terms of complications and deaths. That remains to be seen, but that's where we're at. Now, the concern, as you indicated at the top of this question, Dan, could we see with these viruses being more contagious or transmissible, another surge? And that's really the threat right now. We have not seen it certainly in Ohio, and the US is starting to come down, but as these variants are circulating, that remains to be seen. It is anticipated by the Centers for Disease Control that by March, the predominant circulating virus in the US will be the UK variant. So whether by later in February and March, we're going to see another surge, that would be my prediction right now. But obviously what is interposed here is the use of the vaccines. And we're gonna talk about those in a few minutes and how that will impact on the numbers of cases going forward.
Great. So Bob, the first question, which I think I'll take after the one I just asked you, is how exactly do vaccines work? So let's go through a little 3 minutes of biology for our audience and give you a primer on vaccines. So you recall from an infection with SARS-CoV-2, which is COVID-19, there's a pre-symptomatic phase starting 7 to 10 days before infection. And then as you can see in this dotted line right here, this is the antibody response to the virus that comes up between 10 to 14 days and helps us with immunity to the virus. Now, how do vaccines work? Well, Bob told you the importance of the spike protein, and to understand vaccine technology, we have to take you back to high school biology. DNA is transcribed into RNA. RNA is transcribed into protein, and that protein, in this case, will be the spike protein. And this is the basis of the vaccines that we have. And let's go through them because I think they're very interesting. The genetic vaccines are RNA right now, Moderna and Pfizer, which is a piece of messenger RNA encoded in a lipid particle, which allows that to enter the cell and make the spike protein. The viral vector vaccines from AstraZeneca and Johnson & Johnson are modified adenoviruses, which have DNA. That DNA enters the cell, and that encodes for the spike protein as well, which then leads to, as you will see, antibody and cell-mediated immunity. There are other approaches using inactivated or attenuated coronaviruses, and that, for instance, is the Chinese vaccine, which has reported efficacy rates of 80% in Turkey, but only about 50% in Brazil. That's an inactivated coronavirus, which doesn't cause disease, but elicits an immune response. So how do these vaccines work? Here you see on the left, the Moderna and Pfizer vaccine, which has an mRNA. It enters into the cell. It encodes the spike protein. The spike protein is presented onto the surface, and then we make antibodies or T cell immunity. On the right, you see the adenovirus, which also encodes that spike protein. It enters the cell, injects DNA. The DNA turns to RNA, and then we get the spike protein. Now, there are two types of immunity that you hear about. Antibody-mediated immunity, those of you who've had COVID infection and check your antibodies, that's what you're measuring. Antibodies are two different components of the virus. But then very importantly, there's also something called T-cell immunity, in which activated killer cells recognize the spike protein and then kill the infected cell. There are a lot of vaccine programs underway. Interestingly, not all of them work. And you heard just recently yesterday that Merck has abandoned its vaccine program. And there are now three that are abandoned, two that are approved, and likely Johnson & Johnson to be next with an EUA approximately in February. I'm gonna, Bob, let you comment on this efficacy slide because you were the principal investigator of this trial at University Hospitals that enrolled nearly 200 patients. And I actually had the privilege of participating as a research subject who was fortunately randomized, as I learned only recently, to the active vaccine. So tell us a little bit about what this is showing.
So very important that we were the only institution in Northeastern Ohio involved in this trial of 120 places or sites around the world. And as Dan mentioned, we really had a tremendous amount of folks step forward to be involved in this vaccine trial, which was also placebo controlled. The placebo here was just salt water. And when people took the vaccine, as you can see in the black line, as opposed to those that received placebo, there's a marked difference in terms of protection. The major endpoint here that was evaluated was folks who had symptomatic COVID confirmed cases of COVID. And to that end, after the first injection, which occurred and then looked at 14 days later, there was a protection rate already of about 50% or so. And then by the time after the second dose, and it's shown there, that really expanded the number of protected folks to 95%. This, as Dan will probably show you in a subsequent slide, is as good as it gets in terms of, and it's right here. If you look on the left side, some of the best vaccines we have are tetanus, more recently developed Ebola vaccines, which were used in West Africa and more recently in the Congo, but also measles and chickenpox, et cetera. That's as good as we get. On the right-hand side are some of the characteristics of the storage levels that are required for many of these vaccines, the most important of which is Pfizer. We had to keep this at ultra cold storage, which is the equivalent to what we see at the South Pole. Followed by Moderna, which is really kept in the freezer component of a refrigerator. And importantly, as we move along with approval authorization for the other two vaccines, both Johnson & Johnson and the AstraZeneca vaccine, in conjunction with our colleagues at the University of Oxford in the UK, those can be stored at refrigerated temperatures. And if you start talking about rolling out vaccine globally, where the capacity for these ultra low temperatures basically does not exist, I think we're looking forward to the use of Johnson & Johnson vaccine, which will be next up, probably by the beginning of February, and the AstraZeneca vaccine thereafter, not only for use in the US, but also globally in terms of what I just mentioned.
Terrific, Bob. So I think that we've now given people a pretty good idea of how a vaccine works, how Moderna and Pfizer, which are both messenger RNA vaccines, are very, very safe. But I guess the question that everybody really wants to know is, how long is it going to take us potentially to get to what we call herd immunity, or 70% of the population being protected? So tell us a little bit about that, and then we'll see a little bit about the performance of the U.S. Compared to other countries in vaccination right now.
So other countries, including Israel, are way ahead of us, that Dan will show you. And they've done a remarkable job in rolling out their vaccine. We're doing a bit better now. And of the 40 million vaccines in the US that have been distributed, we now have administered about 20 million, a little over 50%. But weeks ago, we were hardly at that point at all. And this is an important issue in terms of not only vaccine administration, sufficient supply, but also getting it into people's arms. But in terms of how long it's going to take us, I do agree that it's probably around 75% of our population needs to be vaccinated before we reach so-called herd immunity. And that means there are sufficient numbers of people, both by natural infection and importantly through vaccination, that have achieved those immune responses that you showed before. And therefore, there's much less risk of transmitting this virus from person to person. And we could see a significant diminution in the rates of infection. Best estimates are that we're going to reach the general population in the US to vaccinate by maybe as early as June, but certainly into July and August. And therefore, these rates of transmission in cases will probably be significantly diminished by the fall and certainly by the end of 2021. That's our best estimate right now. We'd like to accelerate that. And certainly, the Biden administration is very keen on pushing for the vaccine distribution and administration more rapidly. And I think that would be great. And as I told you before, it looks like the current vaccines we have available will work against the variant viruses, but that's another point of urgency here in terms of getting the general population vaccinated to the point where these variants will then not be transmitted in a sufficient number, and we have to worry about this in the future. One last point is Moderna just announced that they're hedging their bets, so to speak, and are developing, if you will, boosters for the new variants in the event that we have to move in that direction. Because of this technology, which by the way has been in place for over a decade, and it was first being developed, this messenger RNA approach in the development of cancer drugs, and subsequently it was put into play here. The point is that this is not a brand new phenomenon. We have moved quickly as we learn the science, and we're moving at the speed of science, as we say, more so than anything else. And I think with that in mind, it's been very gratifying to see some 9 months later, we're already vaccinating individuals. But in that regard, we have started, this technology allows you to make changes in the vaccine if you need to. So if in the future, one of the questions may be, do we have to be revaccinated in the future? The answer may be, maybe. It really will be dependent on how this goes and whether these variants change even more significantly over time.
So Bob, I have a nice figure because Dr. Fauci and others have been talking about what do we need to get to from a vaccination number, so to speak, to really make a difference. And I think this graph really says it all. Right now, we're doing about 1.5 million vaccine doses per day in the United States. In order for us to get to herd immunity by the fall of 2021, which we all want for our kids going back to school, That would require us to be at 3 million doses a day.
Right.
1.5 million doses a day gets us herd immunity closer to 2022. So everybody here is highly motivated to try to do better. Now let's take a look, as you mentioned, Bob, at the United States. So, you know, how are we doing overall in the country? Well, you can see not very well. And the comparison that I'll use is that Israel has now vaccinated 38 to 40% of its population. It's completed vaccination of those over 65 and has started on the 40 to 65 group. So compare 40% of Israel's population, which is number one in the world, to the best in the US, about 9%, with many other states below 5. Yeah. Well, where were we as of this morning? I downloaded this. The US has vaccinated 5.8% of our population. 41 million doses have been distributed, but only 55% are in the arm. Ohio is actually worse than the national average. At 5.2% of the population, also with only 56% of doses in the arm. Well, let's look at a comparison that came from the weekend. So we have done a lot in the days to advance the total number of doses. So the US has given the largest number of doses overall. But if you look at the number of doses per population, Israel is far and away number one, with UA number two, Britain coming in number three, and so on, as you see here. So there's no question, Bob, that we have a ways to go in improving the efficiency of our vaccine distribution across the country. And I think that, you know, that's the challenge that we face now, which is how are we going to vaccinate more efficiently? Any comments? You know, you've obviously spent, you know, almost three decades in sub-Saharan Africa, where you've seen the WHO ring vaccinate a polio case. They can do 1.5 million people in 48 hours. So tell us, what are we doing wrong in the US?
So that was also the case with smallpox, Dan, when they identified a case and identified close contacts and kept enlarging that circle of contacts accordingly. And smallpox is now eradicated in the world. Polio still exists in certain pockets, but for the most part has been eradicated. And that those are examples where this has really worked. The problem in part has been several fold. One has been the companies currently involved have not been able to keep up with the manufacturing process. So the supply issue is one thing. And the distribution has been spotty. It's getting better over time, but it's been focused mainly back to the states and to health departments. And many of you have read about the fact that public health has been an underestimated, under-resourced area. And when you start looking at all the tasks that they're faced with, including contact tracing, et cetera, it's been already a very stretched workforce that we've really delivered this to. Whether or not we need to start allowing vaccines to be distributed directly to institutions, which hasn't happened yet, could be a possibility to increase the distribution chain, so to speak. We have done a very good job here in our system, Dan, as you know, in terms of using up our allotments, but we're very dependent on the state in that regard. I do think, stating again, our governor and his staff have done an incredible job during the entire pandemic and bringing us to where we're at now, but we need to do a better job. And there'll be new emphasis on this in terms of distribution and supply under the Biden administration. And we look forward to that because we have to get, in his view, in the next 100 days, 100 million doses administered. And that's a tall task, but that's where things stand right now.
Great. So Bob, you know, that's a good segue into how have we been doing, what has been our experience, vaccinating? And let me go to that right now and show you a little bit about what we have been doing. So first of all, it's really important to point out that we have vaccinated at UH as part of phase 1A are any employees who have direct patient contact. In other words, those employees who provide care within 6 feet of patients with COVID or who handle infectious materials. And under that phase 1A, we vaccinated about 17,000 of our employees. Well, the governor, as many of you know, has put in a very aggressive timetable for phase 1B vaccination in the state of Ohio. He announced a tiered system for offering vaccinations to an estimated 2.2 million people who are eligible for the vaccine under this phase. Starting the week of January 19th, those over 80. The week of January 25th, those 75 and up, and those with severe congenital or developmental disorders, but importantly, also includes patients with cystic fibrosis, sickle cell disease, and those with type 1 diabetes. The week of February 1st are those 70 plus and employees of K through 12 schools that wish to remain or return to in-person or hybrid models. And finally, the week of February 8th, those who are 65 and up. Many of you may be asking, why is the governor so fixated on age? And the reason why is on the right. Mortality from COVID exponentially rises in the elderly. So if you look at the comparison group of 18 to 29 years old with COVID, you're 630 times more likely to die from COVID. If you're 75 to 80, 220, 65 to 74, 90 times higher, with hospitalizations that range 5 to 13-fold. So that's really the basis of this recommendation. Bob and I are very pleased to report that UH is vaccinated now over a little over 5,000 80-year-olds. Just today, we vaccinated another 1,500 at our management service center, the old Office Max building on Chagrin in Warrensville. Here's a look at our phase 1B vaccination center, where we have 20 different vaccination stations and a recovery area. And I had the privilege of volunteering there on Saturday as a vaccinator for several hours. And I can tell you nothing is more gratifying than seeing 80-year-olds walking in with canes, walkers, wheelchairs, skipping in. They're so happy to have their vaccine. And from entrance to exit, we're able to get them out in about 25 minutes. So just to give you a sense of, you know, what's happened through January 24th, about a capacity overall of a little over 2,000 for employees, another 1,500 for patients, about 217 total clinic days in only a month, 3,800 hours using both, you know, Moderna and Pfizer. So, you know, I think, Bob, we're trying, but the severest limitation right now is the number of vaccines. Yeah. And, you know, we are trying to schedule our 75-year-olds, our 70-year-olds, and our 65-year-olds, but we're being allocated about 5,500 vaccines a week, which is not clearly enough. Right. And the last thing that we want to do is schedule people for a vaccine date only to cancel because of no allocation.
Yeah.
So, Bob, now we have a lot of really important questions that we got to get through because you are the Dr. Fauci of UH, and that is pregnancy and breastfeeding. Vaccine yes, vaccine no. These pregnant women were not included in the trial, so we're on your and society's recommendations for pregnancy and breastfeeding.
So the answer is they can be offered the vaccine and take it if they wish. But this has to be a very important point of discussion with their primary obstetrician or pediatrician, et cetera. And then they make an informed decision. We are starting a study with Pfizer in pregnant women in mid-February. And so we're going to be enrolling women in the second and third trimester of pregnancy. And then as soon as they delivered, they will be unblinded as to whether they got placebo or the real vaccine, and they'll be vaccinated at that point. We'll be also following the children very carefully thereafter. We do also notice that in the cases of, before this was ever used in humans, there were studies in monkeys, pregnant monkeys, and they showed that it was safe to give, that the mRNA component did not cross the placenta, and those infant monkeys were fine. There was transfer of antibodies across the placenta, however, and as we talk about with influenza, where the mother does transmit antibodies for this and other things, that may be protective for those infants. So that, and we don't think this has major implications in terms of breastfeeding. So those women can take it, but we're gonna have better studies in this group that were not initially included in the trials and others, like folks who are immune compromised, those that are receiving active chemotherapy for cancer and so on and so forth. So we'll have those answers in the future. But right now, if a woman elects to take the vaccine after informed discussion, we will go ahead and give it. And there are several other points. That is, none of these are live virus vaccines. That's where there could be risk to the developing child. And we don't generally give those types of vaccines to pregnant women. But we do other things like tetanus, as well as pertussis vaccination in women that are pregnant, and as well influenza. And those are all examples of killed viruses or bacteria for tetanus, and there have been no untoward effects. So those are reasons that have, I think, made it possible for the societies nationally to recommend that pregnant women be considered for vaccination, even though we'll have more information to inform everybody probably within about 3 or 4 months.
Right, and I think it's important to point out that the issue of pregnancy really rests now predominantly with the healthcare worker population. So yeah, with 7,000 nurses, predominantly female and young, that issue was very important in phase 1A vaccination. In the general public, of course, we're only vaccinating over 65. Okay, so now, Bob, the big questions about side effects.
Yeah.
I was in the Pfizer trial, sore arm, chills, aches, lasted only, you know, a day at best, really no problem with Tylenol and Advil. But tell us about severe reactions, allergy history, and what are we seeing at university hospitals now that we've vaccinated over 20,000? What is our experience with side effects?
Starting with our own experience, we have not seen serious side effects, including the allergic reactions that have been recounted. For Pfizer, there have been 29 cases of severe allergic reactions, including something called anaphylaxis, where people will drop their blood pressures, have difficulty breathing, et cetera. And in those 29, only 3 required hospitalization, no deaths, and for the most part, were easily treated and reversed. And I'll get to what the CDC says about all that in a second. There's just a report about Moderna. In a similar fashion, they saw 10 very severe cases, no deaths, et cetera. And the other 90 were in individuals that had a history of allergic reactions previously. One of the reasons why, and you showed in our setup, we have people wait around after the vaccine is administered, is to monitor for serious side effects. When you look in total at the numbers of severe side effects, those usually occur within 13 minutes on the average. So we hold people who don't have allergic reactions in the past or mild reactions at best for 15 minutes afterwards. And for those that have had more severe reactions, we hold them for 30 minutes. Before they receive the vaccine, if they have any questions, we direct them to have a conversation with their primary care physician, and if necessary, an allergist, either in consultation or someone they follow in that regard. But that's been the extent of things. We don't know right now why these allergic reactions are occurring, because we did not see them in the phase three trials. And aside from that, AstraZeneca, which is not yet approved in the US, had two cases of something called acute transverse myelitis, which is inflammation of the spinal cord. And that can lead to problems with weakness, particularly in the lower extremities. And it's caused by a number of things. For instance, in the initial AstraZeneca trials in phase one, there was a case of such, but they did studies to show that it probably was the first onset of multiple sclerosis in that individual. The second case in their phase three trial, which has not been seen elsewhere, it's been conducted in multiple countries, including in the US. We have not seen this again. And this was very carefully scrutinized by both British authorities and the US FDA and the NIH, because they were co-sponsoring this trial. And they felt comfortable enough in allowing enrollment again once that review was done. Johnson & Johnson, there was one case of a stroke in a vaccine recipient, but that individual had multiple risk factors for such, and they did not think this was vaccine related, but it led to a brief halt in that immunization campaign. So for the most part, these vaccines are very safe. There are side effects, particularly the allergic side effects that we spoke about. So the CDC, in summary, says that if you are allergic to any components of these vaccines, and the components are listed on the CDC site, as well as the individual pharmaceutical sites, then you should probably not receive that vaccine to begin with. But most people have not seen this before. There's been one ingredient called polyethylene glycol, or PEG, that's being investigated as to whether or not this is the culprit. And that is important because, as Dan said, the vaccines, the messenger RNA are encoded, covered, if you will, with this lipid layer, and that keeps that stabilized. But it goes into the cell, and then the mRNA is basically degraded pretty quickly after it delivers the goods, if you will. And it doesn't last, because there have been other questions about modifications of the genetic code in an individual given these vaccines, but that's not happened. So with that in mind, we're really monitoring this very carefully. And if people have other side effects, including anaphylaxis to other medications, but not to vaccines, they're allowed to proceed with informing anyone in the hospital situation that that happened. We watch these people very carefully. But that's
all. Bob, I think it's really important that our listeners understand that there's a risk benefit here.
Yeah.
And I want you to know, as a cardiologist, that we are approaching, we will have over 500,000 deaths in a 12-month period from this virus. This is not the flu. Flu in the United States causes 25,000 to 60,000 deaths. This is going to be in its course over 500,000, and has had periods where it surpassed cancer and heart disease as the number one killer of Americans. So, you have to balance, especially those with risk factors, namely high blood pressure, diabetes, lung disease, heart disease, immunosuppression, and others. Obesity is a very big one, and obviously pregnancy. So it's a risk benefit that you have to weigh individually, but it's one that I think, uniformly physicians would recommend. And it's important to point out that at university hospitals, about 80 to 85% of our employees have agreed to vaccination. It is not mandatory. We do not feel that emergency use authorization would allow us to make a vaccine mandatory. We will need more information for regular FDA approval. Okay, Bob, we have time for a few more questions, and then we have to turn it back to Beth. There is a question, and I think this is really important, so I want everybody to listen to this answer. If I'm vaccinated, and I get to the 10 to 14 days after my second vaccine, so I'm now at that immune 95% efficacy, do I still have to mask and socially distance and be careful?
The answer is yes, quite simply, because what we don't know yet, and we'll have this answer relatively soon, is that we have seen cases, first of all, after the first dose, before the second, where people have actually developed COVID, number one. Remember, it takes time to get up to that 95% protection rate. And number two, in the Pfizer study that we conducted at UH, and the AstraZeneca, which we're doing as well, as long as people had no symptoms, they could be enrolled in the study, even if they tested positive for COVID at the outset. And what we're going to be doing is following these people longitudinally to see whether or not the vaccines will diminish or resolve the amount of virus that they're shedding. So we don't know that answer yet. My suspicion is it will. And therefore, after we get to that point and people are vaccinated in larger numbers, we'll be able to gradually lift some of these infection control measures. But let me also tell you another message about these infection control measures. Dan and I have spoken about this before. Starting back in the Southern Hemisphere during their winter season, where they saw in Australia only 70 cases of influenza with all these measures in place versus what they usually see at over 70,000. And the entire country of South Africa, they had one confirmed case. And that has been seen here in the Northern Hemisphere. We're seeing less influenza, other respiratory viral infections. Children are not coming in for exacerbation of their asthma as much and other things that are often triggered by viruses. So there's a, and I say this carefully, a silver lining to COVID. I'd never like to say that, but there we know that these measures work. We have to continue to practice them for now, but I think in the near future, as we get this additional information, we'll be able to make more definitive statements on that very question that you've raised.
So Bob, we know from the Pfizer trial that children 16 to 18 were included, but obviously all of our parents and grandparents who have children and grandchildren who are really want to get back to school 100% in person are wondering about childhood vaccination. Yeah. Tell us a little bit about the trials that are underway. I think, as you mentioned, down to 9 years old, which would at least encompass a large percentage of our school age.
Right, so that's true. And I know both Pfizer and Moderna are doing that as we speak. Counter to that is the idea that many studies have been published now that children less than the age of 9, if they get COVID, and that's not to underestimate that, it's relatively asymptomatic and there are few cases. And in in-person classroom where they've looked at COVID transmission, it's been relatively few in that respect. So the 9-year-old point is a very important one because above 9, that's where transmission can occur more frequently. And I think, remember that the original Pfizer vaccine enrolled down to the age of 12. But they did not have sufficient numbers for the FDA panel to approve it, except at the age of 16 and above. Moderna got authorization for 18 and above. So we're going to have that information soon. And it's always been said, because of the less frequent occurrence of COVID in children and less complications, although some have certainly been reported, that they'll be at the end of the line. Now, in most clinical trials, that's the case. We study children after we do adults because we want to make sure it's really safe before we put them into children. But I think we're getting there and we'll have those answers for everybody in a relatively short period of time.
So Bob, final question for you. We're getting several questions about, tell us about your personal vaccine experience. How did it go for you? Which vaccine did you get and how did you feel?
Even though I was the principal investigator for Pfizer, I couldn't do it as a conflict of interest because this study is still going on for 2 years as we observe for long-term safety signals and also for continued durability of the immune response over that time. So I had to get Moderna and all I had was, I know you were a little different. You've already mentioned it, Dan. I had just soreness in my arm, which lasted maybe 12 to 18 hours and it was gone, treated with Tylenol and I was good. I get my second vaccine tomorrow. So we'll see how that goes, and I can report to you back about that. But you had a different experience of it.
Yeah, I think that, you know, I did not notice, it's interesting, a lot of the healthcare workers right now are going through the second, and they're reporting a slightly, you know, worse symptoms on a second shot. I really did not notice that at all. And I would classify my symptoms for everybody who's watching is very similar to a shingles vaccine, which I had. And so I would say it was, in my view, it was mild.
Yeah.
Well, with that, we're going to turn it back over to Beth. Beth, it's we both are so happy that you invited us to come today and to educate the Federation. Obviously, very special to me, but also very special to Bob, because Bob and I are regulars at NCJW, and he is the Fauci of Jewish Cleveland now. So thank you so much for inviting us, and we look forward to coming back. Thank you.
Yes. Thank you.
Well, we are so happy to have had you here today. And I know that you've answered a lot of the questions that we've all been grappling with. I know I speak for everyone who joined us here tonight that we're so grateful to have both of you as part of our community. We thank you so much for your timely perspective and insight. And to everyone who participated tonight in today's webinar, we appreciate you sharing your afternoon with us and hope you found this time as meaningful as I did. We hope you all stay connected and stay informed. A recording of this webinar will be accessible on the Federation's website. So please reach out to the Federation if you'd like a transcript of this webinar. Information about the resources mentioned today will be distributed through email as a follow-up to today's session. I also invite you to join the Federation for many upcoming events, including the new weekly wellness series, which is beginning in early February. This will offer a variety of virtual events for all ages that support our mind, body, spirit, and community. The first of these events is on February 15th and is called Appreciative Cooking with Chef Doug Katz. More details will be coming soon. So thank you all for attending today. Stay safe and stay healthy, and have a great evening.